I'm Tom Clyde with the litigation group at Dow Lohnes. I essentially work with you with the question back, and I'm going to try and walk you through some of the changes and some of the things that stayed the same under the new open records act. I'll take a look at your materials, which I think are terrific. I want to also alert you to some other documents that I think are helpful. Number one, this PowerPoint is on the Georgia First Amendment Foundation's website, gfaf.org. But another document that I think is very helpful to see if you have questions about how the Open Records Act has changed from the prior version to the new one is going to the Georgia General Assembly site and looking up HB 397. That was House Bill 397. That's what was signed by the governor and became the new Open Records Act and new Open Meetings Act. If the as-passed version gives you a very clear presentation of what the law was before and what got changed. And basically, a great deal of the law stayed the same. The real thrust, the real effort, I think, by both Attorney General Olens and the sponsor, Jay Powell, was to try and make the law clearer. I think that succeeded in some parts. We'll go through some parts of the law today where it's not much clearer. But the as-passed version of HB 397 basically goes line for line about what is no longer in the law and what is the new language in the law. So it's a worthwhile document to take a look at. Basically what we're going to do is walk through a PowerPoint a little bit today that's going to take a look at some of the most significant changes both in the Open Records Act, and then Holly and Sean McIntosh are going to take a look at the Open Meetings Act. I'm going to start with the Open Records Act. One of the things, the way this PowerPoint presentation generally works is that existing law is represented in white and changes to the law are represented in gold. And as I mentioned, this is also on the Georgia First Amendment Foundation website. So the first thing we're going to take a look at is what records are covered by the Open Records Act. And in many respects, I'd say almost all respects, the law remains the same. And the law remains a extraordinarily broad law for reaching what the Open Records Act reaches is all records that are prepared or received by a government agency. So it is sweepingly broad in its reach. It's one of the broadest Open Records Act laws in terms of the information that it reaches in the country. A few things were clarified. It reaches all documents, papers, letters, maps, books. All these things are itemized in the language of the Act itself. A few additions were made to make even more clear. It was clear under the old law, but it was to make even more clear that the new Open Records Act reaches computer information, information that exists only on computers. So the old law referred to computer-based or generated information. The new law also adds to that data fields, and also makes clear email is covered. I think, frankly, under the old law, it had become clear that email is covered. The new law spelled out that email and other electronic messages, so that would include even text messages, are covered under the Act. So who is subject to open records laws? A great deal, virtually all of traditional government, is covered, whether that's at the municipal level, whether that's at the county level, whether it's at the state level, are generally covered by the Open Records Act. The Open Records Act also reaches a little more broadly than that in some unusual ways. And one of those ways is it reaches, and you can see this in the gold, that when this was clarified under the new law, nonprofits receiving 1/3 of their funds from taxpayers or associations of counties, municipalities, and school boards that received 1/3 of their funds from political subdivisions. So a great deal of nonprofits that are essentially vehicles for government agencies are clearly covered by the Open Records Law. So there is some language that is very important to the reach of the Open Records Act that was continued from the old law to the new law. And that is at the bottom of this slide. Records of private persons or entities performing a service or function on behalf of an agency or for storage or future governmental use. Particularly this language, performing a service or function on behalf of an agency, is very important language, and very important language that was continued from the old law to the new law. That language was added in approximately 1999, and what it was intended to do is reach out and make sure that private organizations, when they are essentially taking over a government function or performing a service for government, are subject to the Open Records Act. So for a great deal of private organizations that are working closely with government, they too are subject to the Open Records Act have to comply with providing access to documents that reflect the services they're performing for government. That is, candidly, in many respects, a surprise to private organizations. But it is, in my experience, actually, for a lot of private organizations, they are surprised to receive an open records request. They consult with their attorneys, they look at the language of the law, and frequently just comply. It is one of the things that I think is one of the really special parts of the Georgia Open Records Act, and I think it was very important that the Attorney General and Representative Powell continue that language into the new law. So the next thing I'm going to take a look at briefly is the process for record requests. And that is slightly changed under the new law. And so I want to walk through that, and I think a little later today there's going to be more time spent on the process of open records requests. First issue that comes up is sort of, how do you make an Open Records Act request? Can you make it orally? Can you make it verbally? Or does it have to be in writing? That was a source of some controversy during this legislation moving through the General Assembly. And the ultimate outcome was that you can make an Open Records Act request either orally or in writing. It is perfectly okay to make an Open Records Act request orally, verbally, by just asking for the documents under the Open Records Act. But in order to, if there becomes a conflict, if there becomes a dispute between the individual making the request and the agency, that in order to get the advantage of the penalties in the act, the person making the request is going to have to reduce it to writing. So an oral request is valid, but in order to get the advantage of the penalties, it's going to have to be reduced to writing at some point. So why was that the resolution? To a certain extent, it reflects a concern by government. We're going to go over the penalty provisions have gotten more significant under the new law. And there was concern by government agencies that oral requests are very hard to keep track of, that they could be facing punishment for an oral request that got lost in the system, essentially, and they could be facing significant penalties as a result. So the resolution of that, at the same time, certainly access advocates, including the First Amendment Foundation, were saying the process of reducing every request to writing, number one, is cumbersome, number two, can be intimidating to citizens. It is their records, it is their right to those records, they should be able to just simply ask for them and get access to the records. The resolution was to allow oral requests, but to make a system where the punishment can only be imposed if it's been actually moved to a written form. So a written request is required for enforcement. Who does that written request go to? Traditionally, under the old law, it went to the custodian of the records. It went to the person that was in custody of the records. that continues to be true, but a custodian, a specific Open Records Act custodian, can now be designated by an agency. So what does that mean? An agency can actually say, we want all of our Open Records Act requests to go to this individual. That if they make that election, if they make that choice, then that custodian has to be listed on the agency's website. You have to be able to call the agency and immediately find out who that custodian is. There's various, they actually have to advertise it at some point. There's various mechanisms that require the agency to be very forcefully publishing and informing the public about who that custodian is so that Open Records Act requests can be sent to that individual. There's no requirement that a custodian be designated. It's simply an option available to an agency. Some issues come up with the custodian. What if the custodian is not there when we send the Open Records Act? What if it's vacation? What if it's a two-week vacation? There is a lot of concern about the custodian, the idea of designating a single custodian. The law is pretty forceful in making, well, it makes very clear, number one, if the custodian is not there, that is not the requester's problem. In other words, the request has to be sent to the custodian, but when the custodian is not available, somebody's going to have to sub in for the custodian because the time periods under the Act will run from receipt even in the absence of the custodian being physically present. It's also clear that, if that agency is using email, the request can be sent by email. Obviously, for most of the agencies, certainly in the Atlanta metropolitan area, but mostly throughout the state, they're going to be using email. There's a few very small government agencies that may not, and that was the concern. But there's a lot of different ways of submitting an Open Records Act request to that custodian as a result. So the next step after the receipt of a request is the records need to be produced within a reasonable amount of time, not to exceed 3 days. That is the same language that existed under the old law. Really continues what has been one of the best aspects of the Georgia Open Records Act, and that is the idea that government not only needs to provide the records, but needs to provide the records on a timely basis. There cannot be a significant delay between the request itself and ultimately the production of the records. We're going to actually look also at what happens if there's exception, if the records are covered, but this flowchart really looks at what happens when the records are available and are covered by the Open Records Act. So the records need to be produced for inspection within a reasonable amount of time, not to exceed three days, for very simple, for records that are immediately available and don't involve a lot of analysis, then that should be immediately. Even the preamble to the Open Records Act that is included in the law itself emphasizes that immediate production should be done whenever possible. So what happens if the records are not available within 3 days? They are off-site, they are in use, they are in a place where they cannot be accessed in order to be provided. If some, but not all, records are available within 3 days, then a number of obligations basically arise with respect to the government agency. The first thing they have to do is, within that 3-day time period, they have to describe the records and provide a timeline for their production, a date for their production. That was true under the old law. It is true under the new law. And the new law also imposes a new obligation that now those records, you can't just simply say, hey, they're not available at the moment. You can't pick a date way into the future. the government agency is going to have to provide the records as soon as practicable. That is the language in the new law. So there is, even if they're not immediately available, there is still going to be an expectation on the government agency that is moving forward as quickly as practicable to make those records available. If some, but not all, are available within 3 days, the Act also requires enrolling production. And this is a new aspect of the new Open Records Act. There was a concern that on many occasions government agencies had basically said the records aren't available and had delayed their ultimate production for a significant period of time and had failed to provide even some of the records, even the records that were immediately available during that time period. So now the new law is clear that there's got to be a rolling production during that time period. If records within the scope of the request are available, they need to be produced during as they become available. And then the rest of the records need to be produced during identified and described and identified in a timeline that needs to be complied with. So that is basically the scenario when records are not subject to an exception with the Act. And eventually we're going to start taking a look at some of the exceptions to the Open Records Act. And there are many. There are many under the old law, and there are many under the new law. But what happens if some of the records are not subject to the Act because they fall within one of the exceptions to the Open Records Act? At that point, a different set of obligations arises for a government agency. They have to provide a written response, and the written response has to identify specifically what is the legal basis for withholding the records. In order to be in compliance with the Act, within that 3 days, there has to be a written response, and that written response has to identify the legal basis. Then all portions of the records that are not subject to that exception need to be provided. So that is another aspect when records are subject to any of the exceptions. I'm going to also look at one thing that I think may be relevant in particular to this group, that is a completely, actually this, both of these should be in gold, my mistake, but this is a new aspect of the Open Records Act that was attempting to address a concern that government attorneys reasonably had with respect to the litigation process, the intersection of the Open Records Act and the litigation process. Obviously, during ongoing litigation, attorneys have the right to issue subpoenas and requests for production of documents under the Georgia Civil Practice Act. But for all of us that litigate, there's frequently advantages to submitting a Open Records Act request, either when you're litigating with an agency or when you're litigating among private parties and want some records that are in the possession of the government. There was concern about the process of using the Open Records Act during litigation. By various parties, that ultimately got ironed out in the legislative process this way. If a litigant makes a request in ongoing civil litigation or an ongoing administrative proceeding, then the response has to be handled in a somewhat different way than is typical. The written request itself has to be copied to counsel of record contemporaneously with the submission of the request. So kind of like a subpoena, if you're in the midst of litigation and you are issuing an Open Records Act request, you then need to copy that Open Records Act request to all the counsel of record. Everybody gets to be aware that you are issuing an Open Records Act request in the midst of ongoing civil litigation. The agency shall produce a duplicate copy of all records produced unless counsel for the agency waives. What is that? That concern arises out of this issue. government attorneys were essentially seeing for the first time that their agency, another arm of their agency, had produced records in litigation without them being aware of it, because it had occurred pursuant to an Open Records Act process as opposed to a subpoena process. So now the government agency's attorneys itself get a copy of the records, a duplicate copy, as they're being produced, unless they waive it. The idea is to try and make sure everybody's in the litigation process is equally informed as if it's taking place during that process. So I am going to now move on essentially to another aspect of the law that got slightly changed in the legislative process. So under the old law, it was appropriate if an agency chose to try and recover certain charges in connection with responding to an Open Records Act request. In order to recover charges under the Open Records Act, under the old law and the new law, one of the things an agency has to do is submit an estimate of those costs, an estimate of the cost of compliance to the party that is making the request. And then designate essentially what are the charges that they are going to incur and are going to try and recover from the requester. So under the new law, one of the additions is a government agency may make a reasonable charge for search, retrieval, redaction, copying, and production. There was a great deal of controversy over the cost of redaction, who was to bear that cost in connection with the Open Records Act. The ultimate conclusion through the legislative process is that a government agency could recover the costs of redaction for complying with the Open Records Act. So I think probably this audience, most everybody knows what redaction is, but just to make sure, if a document, let's say it's a letter, has within it certain attorney-client privileged information, but the rest of the correspondence is not subject to the attorney-client privilege, then that attorney-client privileged information can be redacted from the letter, but the rest of the letter has to be produced. That process of physically going through documents and eliminating that portion of information by a clerk in connection with a large production of documents can involve some expense. That process is now, that expense can now be recovered by a government agency, as we're going to see they have to use the lowest paid qualified employee to physically make those redactions, but that is a expense that can be recovered. Also, the cost of search, retrieval, and essentially finding the documents, getting the documents. But this is really, when we're talking about these kind of expenses, we're really talking about very large Open Records Act requests. Open Records Act requests that will take a government agency many hours to handle. Search, retrieval, redaction, copying, and production. So that process all has to be done, all has to be billed, the estimate has to be billed at the prorated hourly salary of the lowest paid qualified employee. And so the estimate has to basically lay out what is the hourly charge that is being used so that there can be some assessment of whether that is the lowest paid qualified employee. One of the things that, and that was true under the old law, the new law makes a significant change, and that I think is also a reflection of Attorney General Lohnes very wisely trying to negotiate a resolution between the differing interests in the Open Records Act. The new law reduces the cost of copying. The previous cost of copying was 25 cents per page. That cost per page was wildly higher than the actual cost that government agencies were incurring. And so it is now moved down to 10 cents per page, which is at least significantly closer to the cost that government agencies incur. What does that mean? It's in a, if you are making an Open Records Act request for 1,000 documents or 5,000 pages of records, that is a significant financial savings, and more accurately reflects the cost the government agency will incur. In a sense, that change and the allowing government agencies to recover the cost of redaction were two decisions that were made to try and balance out the equitable interests in the copying process. So a lot of times you're not just asking for a 8.5 by 11 piece of paper, you're asking for other documents that are in government's hands. And those documents need to be, whether it's a map, whether it's electronic documents, those are basically billed at the actual cost of producing the document or other media. So if it's an exotic map that needs to be reproduced in a way that incurs significantly more cost, it's appropriate to charge for that. One of the things that also brings to bear is it's increasingly possible to not produce documents in their physical form, but to produce them in electronic form, to produce them as PDFs, to produce them in that form. And the new Open Records Act really encourages electronic production. If something's being handed over on a thumb drive, then it should be the cost of the thumb drive. But it is an effort to try and reduce, to get the government agencies to try and reduce their costs and reduce the cost for the citizens that are making, ultimately making the request. So some other issues that come up in connection with cost. An agency is not required to charge for an Open Records Act request. Obviously, the federal government frequently waives charges in connection with Open Records Act requests, and that is also the prerogative of all agencies under the state open records law. Inspection is allowed. So in other words, you don't have to, and particularly with the media, we certainly encourage reporters to take a look at records before asking for copies. That frequently reduces the scope of the request and allows government agencies, it makes it easier for both the requester and the government agency to narrow down what they are asking for instead of having a huge volume of paper produced. You can also produce with your own portable device. That was actually true under the Open Records Act. I don't know who included that language under the old Open Records Act, but they were seeing into the future. It really has never been practical, but it is now becoming practical. In other words, portable scanners are now becoming effective and efficient and useful. So I do think over the course of the next 3 or 4 years, it is going to be increasingly frequent for people that are using government records a lot to go into government agencies with their own portable scanner. It's a handheld device, and just whip through records. That is a right they have under the Open Records Act. Or obviously, we all can now take a photograph of a document with our cell phone and make a copy of a piece of paper that way. The new law continues that as an option available to requesters. If it can be made available by electronic means, it should. That was what I was mentioning before. The new law and the old law encourage the use of electronic production of records. One thing that's important, an important part of the old law and new law that continues, is that the first quarter hour that a government agency expends in responding to an Open Records Act is free, and an acknowledgement that basically government agencies are all working for the public, and the public should have a right to go see routine government records without incurring a cost. but that the cost recovery process should really apply for the most significant Open Records Act requests that involve much more resources. The agency shall utilize the most economic means available for producing and providing public records. There was language in that, like that in the old law. It is even more vigorous in the new law. So it is an expectation that the Open Records Act process should not become a profit center for government agencies, but that it should be, cost should be imposed using the most economical means and so that there's no greater imposition on the public making the request. So one of the things that also came up during the legislative process is can attorney's fees, can the cost of having an attorney review records to determine whether they're subject to the Open Records Act be included in the act. That was included in an early version of the bill. It created a real firestorm of concern, and it was removed from the bill. So I think it is pretty clear attorney's fees cannot be included in any costs that are recovered. A Georgia Court of Appeals decision specifically looked at that issue under the old law and specifically found no, that can't be included in costs. If the legislature had intended for it to be included in costs, they would have specifically said so. In this legislative process, the cost of attorney's fees was specifically came up, and it was specifically pulled out of the legislation. So the legislative history makes very clear that attorney's fees are not part of costs that can be recovered in the Open Records Act process. So one of the things the new law did was try and address a concern that had frequently come up under the old law, and balance the interests of both the requesters and the government agencies in terms of making sure that they would not be put to the expense of having to respond to an Open Records Act request and then never get paid for that expense. So the new law attempts to create a system that balances basically everybody's interest in that, and I think it came out pretty well. So If the cost of responding to an Open Records Act request is less than $25, a government agency is expected to proceed with preparing the documents. In other words, is expected to proceed with preparing the documents and present the bill to the individual when they arrive to come retrieve the documents. However, if the cost is going to exceed $25, then the government agency is allowed to await approval by the requester. In other words, to send estimates saying that the cost of us responding to your Open Records Act request will be $72.50. Please confirm that you are going to pay that amount, and we will make the records available. It's allowed to get confirmation that that payment is going to occur. The $25 amount was sent to try and balance the interests of the parties, but it can also be adjusted by the requester itself. Particularly for attorneys, I think it is not uncommon for attorneys to submit an Open Records Act request where they're saying if the costs are going to exceed $50 or going to exceed $75, please let us know. That is allowable. In other words, that is an appropriate step to include in your Open Records Act request. And at that point, the government agency needs to move forward with preparing your documents. They've gotten the confirmation they need that they can go to $75, if that's the amount you've spent, before they hold up the production process. Essentially, that's an important piece of information that you want to include in your Open Records Act request. You want to where is it that you need to be notified before they cross the financial line? Otherwise, you are expecting them to proceed with production of records to that point. But if you don't specify it, the number will be $25. For very large Open Records Act requests, government agencies are understandably concerned. We're not only concerned that we want confirmation that the individual is going to pay, but we want the money. And so if a cost is to exceed $500, an agency may, it's not required to, but an agency may insist on prepayment of costs prior to producing the records. So in that situation, for very large Open Records Act requests, they can say, when you deliver the check, we'll make the records available. This last provision is essentially intended to help government agencies in situations where individuals are making serial Open Records Act requests but not paying the fees or not even coming to retrieve the records. And that says, if a requester has failed to pay previously for a valid Open Records Act request, in other words, the government agency's gone to the effort of gathering the records, they made the records available, the individual failed to retrieve the records, failed to pay for the cost that the agency incurred, then at that point going forward, the government agency can require upfront prepayment, even under the $500 level. So that is a situation. There was concern by government agencies that a very small number of requesters was imposing a great deal of cost on certain agencies, almost as a form of harassment, and in some cases perhaps as a form of harassment. And so the idea was try to bring that under control by imposing cost mechanisms, by imposing fees in that form. So for those requesters, an agency can start insisting on payment up front and use that as a mechanism to prevent a sort of an abuse of the agency. If they're willing to pay, they're entitled to the records, but they're going to have to pay that cost up front. So one thing I want to touch on is some new provisions of the new Open Records Act law that I think are very helpful in clarifying electronic records, requests for electronic records, because our old Open Records Act, as time had moved on, was having a great deal of difficulty, as with many laws, applying it to the modern environment where a lot of requests are for electronic records and for data. So one of the most important, there's a number of statements in the new Open Records Act law that are very important for government agencies to keep in mind in terms of how they are setting up their own computer systems, including in their negotiations with their vendors. One of the statements the new Open Records Act makes very clear is that an agency's use of electronic record keeping shall not erode the right of the public to access public records. It can't be that government agencies set up their computer systems in a way that make it very difficult or very expensive for members of the public to access the records that are being created by government agencies that they themselves pay for through their taxes. So that broad statement, and there's various other similar statements in the Act, is very important in terms of on a moving forward basis, agencies keeping in mind how they set up their computer systems. Agencies must produce electronically unless a requester prefers print or copying, or copying is needed for redaction. Again, it's this effort to try and make this a much more electronic process than one that's involving a lot of physical paper copies. So this last aspect, inputting range, filter, search information is not programming or creating a new record if it uses existing programs used by the agency. So this was an area of significant controversy under the old law. Increasingly, requests are made for data that is maintained by government, whether it's data about how our road systems or data about the various citizens and how citizens, the uses that citizens are making of government services. But increasingly, some of the most informative things that government keeps are databases of information about the services they're providing, about the services that are being used by citizens. That data is available to the public to try and assess whether government is operating on an efficient basis. But there was questions increasingly when those kind of requests are made about, all right, well, how much is government supposed to do to provide that data? That data is frequently kept it's obviously kept electronically, and in order to output the data, some instructions have to be given to the computer system to get that system, that information exported. Government agencies were frequently raising the concern, and raising a concern that them having to type in instructions to export certain files or export certain portions of a database was itself programming. And it is the case that government agencies, even under the new law, are not required to create a program. But the new law makes very clear that no, simply inputting instructions so that information is exported by the computer is not in itself programming. As long as you're using the existing programs that the agency uses to handle that data, that in itself is not programming, and so it is an appropriate Open Records Act request, and the agency needs to comply. The Open Records Act, new Open Records Act law gets pretty deep into this topic, which is great, and makes clear that those data or data files may be produced in standard export formats. In other words, it can either be produced in the organic form it was kept, or it can be produced in standard export formats in which basically the data is called tab delimited and clear and provided in a way that can be used by the user without providing the program. Another big topic, obviously, in modern government communications is email. Just like private organizations, government increasingly uses email to communicate. The public is frequently very interested in some or particular emails that have been related to government activity. So the new act makes clear it is appropriate to ask for email or other electronic communications. But it specifically directs the requester to try and provide as much specificity as possible in terms of whose particular email is wanted, name, title, and databases, if possible. If possible language is included in the Open Records, the new Open Records Act law itself. But it is a reflection that I think all attorneys increasingly grapple with, is that electronic discovery, electronic access to trying to find particular emails is sometimes a cumbersome process, depending on how the email structure is set up. So the more specificity the requester makes, the easier it is to accomplish. So the Act is specifically encouraging the requesters to provide all the specificity they can. And I think that's a practical matter and worthwhile in terms of trying not to submit an Open Records Act request that the response by government is, well, that will cost $24,000 to search all that email. The more specificity that is made in with respect to an email request, the easier it is for the government agency to hone in on it. Here is another issue that the new law deals with that can that I think is very practical in the way it resolves the controversy. An agency may put records on its website. Frequently, government agencies will receive Open Records Act requests for the same document over and over again. And that process can be a little bit cumbersome, having to hand out that document. So one of the things it allows a government agency to do is say, look, we've posted it to our website. The new law allows them to say that. That is a reasonable response to an Open Records Act request. But an Open Records Act requester can still ask for it in physical form and can still ask for the underlying data. So what does that mean? Increasingly, government agencies have information online where, for example, if you put in your address, you can find out certain information about your home that government agency is maintaining on you. Or something along those lines, where you put in a piece of information and you get a specific piece of information back. Government agencies were occasionally saying, look, if when somebody asked for that entire database, the government agency would say, it's online. You go do it. You can just type in everybody's address one by one and you can get all the data out. Obviously, that undermines the entire process of getting access to a database. So the new law makes clear you can't require a requester to go out and try and scrape the public database. It is reasonable, if it's otherwise subject to the ask, to ask for the underlying data itself. So one of the things the new Open Records Act specifically says, this was not in the old law, is that if an agency contracts with a private vendor, the arrangement shall not impede public record access. That's a very important and helpful development. Some of the most progressive government agencies in Georgia had long ago started including in their contracts with government vendors statements that government vendor would comply with the Open Records Act, that government vendor was aware that providing access to records was a mandatory part of Georgia law. The new law now makes clear that's an obligation of every government agency in the state of Georgia, that when you're making a relationship with a vendor relating to public records or public record information, part of the analysis has to be making sure that arrangement is not going to put records off limits to the public. So we're going to touch now, we're going to move into what is always sort of the most controversial area of the Open Records Act, which is the exemptions. The Open Records Act, the old Open Records Act, the new Open Records Law, both have more than 40 specific exceptions to certain types of records. In other words, certain types of records are exempt from the obligation of a government agency to make them available. I am not going to try and touch on all of those. Many of them are very obscure. And some of them you can't even quite understand where they came from, but they're sort of artifacts of history. But I will touch on some of the ones that come up most frequently in Open Records Act requests. So, for some time under the old law, and continued under the new law, is a recognition that government maintains a great deal of information on individuals, including its own government employees. That is itself potentially creates identity theft issues. And so the new Open Records Act continues protection for things that I think we would all intuitively recognize shouldn't be being produced on a wholesale basis. So social security number, bank account, medical records, other things on this list. It expanded that list somewhat. Cell phone information, personal email information is not subject to the Open Records Act, meaning if that's contained in a document, that information can be redacted from that document before a government agency produces it to the public. It also clarified some other issues. Employee protections applied to retirees. This last issue is an important one. Certain exemptions that exist in the Open Records Act are understandably there to protect public employees and to protect public employees from identity theft. but increasingly government agencies had invoked those protections when Open Records Act requests had been made for records that were otherwise available, including records that are on file, for example, at the courthouse, and said, well, some of those records might have information about them, information in them that would be protected if that individual happened to be a government employee, and we can't tell you whether they're a government employee. We can't. Some of our government employees might be in that database, so we're not producing that information. The new law makes clear those exemptions only apply to records that specifically identify the individual employees by either their jobs, titles, or offices. So other exemptions, here's a significant change in the new law. The information, I think, obviously, I think we're all generally familiar with HIPAA. HIPAA was any records that are not allowed to be released under federal law or required to be withheld under federal law must be withheld. That's continued in the new law. HIPAA is one of those laws and was understood to be one of those laws that restrict medical information. The new law now makes clear FERPA. FERPA is basically the law, is also one of those laws. FERPA is the law that protects the privacy of educational records. It's a federal law that protects private educational records. It is enforced in this way. If a public agency that receives money from the federal government violates FERPA, in other words, discloses students' records when it shouldn't, it can be at risk for having the federal educational funds withdrawn. In other words, it's sort of an indirect penalty. The Georgia Supreme Court had looked specifically at that issue and said, we do not see that as an exemption to our Open Records Act. They had held that FERPA shouldn't be interpreted as an exemption to our Open Records Act, and so particularly with respect to some records, since the case involved the University of Georgia and a student court there, the court required production of the records. Over time, the federal courts had, on a number of occasions, expressed criticism of the, what's called the red and black decision, and increasingly, government agencies were caught in a difficult position of being concerned that they would be violating FERPA or concerned that they were going to violate the Open Records Act. The new law, so if they complied with the Open Records Act, they'd be in violation of FERPA. If they complied with FERPA, they'd be in violation of the Open Records Act. The new law brings those two things together. In other words, if it is a violation to produce the records under FERPA, it is now a valid exemption under the Georgia Open Records Act. So there's no longer that inconsistency between those two, the way those two are interpreted. Other records that are, not surprisingly, there continues to be exceptions for individuals that are in a very vulnerable position, records relating to child abuse, records relating to police confidential informants. Here's two of the most significant exceptions to the Open Records Act that come up the most. They remain in the new law. They were as they were in the old law. If the government agency undertakes an investigation to discipline or about a complaint about an employee or in connection with a disciplinary action against an employee, that file, that investigation, the records from that investigation can remain confidential until 10 days after they are presented to an agency for action. In other words, the idea is that once those records are presented to a government agency, that agency has 10 days to take action with respect to the results of that investigation. If it fails to take action in that time, then the records have to be released to the public anyway. But it essentially gives a time period for the agency to assess, discuss, deliberate, and ultimately take action with what the investigation has found. another very large exception to the Open Records Act that comes up frequently is the records of law enforcement in a pending investigation or prosecution. So records of a law enforcement agency or a regulatory agency can be withheld from the public and the press until that investigation is closed or the case is basically it's gone through its final appeal. So as long as the case remains pending, either as an investigation or remains pending as a case in going through the prosecution process, the records can be withheld by a law enforcement agency. Doesn't mean they have to be withheld. The government agency, law enforcement agencies can obviously choose to release records to advance their investigation, but they can invoke that exception. So one thing the new law did that is extremely helpful is it clarified to whom does that exception apply. And it made very clear that that exception applies to law enforcement. In other words, increasingly, the government agencies that were the subject of the investigation, that were the target of the investigation, were refusing to comply with Open Records Act requests, saying, hey, we think we're under investigation by a law enforcement agency, so we're not going to provide records on this. That is not who this exception was intended to prevent, and now the new law makes very clear the target of an investigation cannot prevent public scrutiny of what went wrong. That is a prerogative that is reserved entirely to law enforcement or the regulatory agency itself. So the new law says it does not apply to records in the possession of an agency that is the subject of the investigation. I will give you an example that came up, for example, in the City of Atlanta Schools investigation. They are obviously under investigation. But they themselves were refusing to provide records to go to under the Open Records Act, saying that essentially those were law enforcement records in a pending investigation. That the new law makes very clear that is not a valid invocation of that exception. Two other exceptions that got clarified. Trade secrets. Trade secrets existed as an exception to the Open Records Act under the old law. It continues to exist in the new law, but it is being clarified how that exception should work. A corporation, when it's now submitting what it contends are trade secrets to a government agency, is now expected to submit with those trade secrets an affidavit saying the following documents we submit are trade secrets and making clear which documents are it purports to be trade secrets. At that point, if a government agency gets that affidavit and then a government agency subsequently gets an Open Records Act request for those documents, the government agency at that point is expected to notify the organization that submitted the purported trade secrets to the government agency before it produces them. In other words, the government agency isn't required to agree that they are trade secrets. It may take a look at the affidavit and conclude they are trade secrets, or it may take a look at the affidavit and conclude they're not trade secrets. But the government agency does have to notify the organization that submitted those records before it produces those records. That essentially gives the private organization that submitted what it believes to be trade secrets the opportunity to frankly defend itself, to go to court itself, and try and get an injunction if it doesn't want those records produced. It also has the benefit of frankly getting the government agency out of the middle. The idea was to try and get the government agency out of the middle of this process, which is really ultimately becomes between the requester and the private organization that submitted the documents at issue. But I think that's a very helpful, worthwhile, and good balance to reach. It was frankly where under the Open Records Law, a lot of agencies were handling it that way. It is now engrafted specifically into the law itself. Property acquisition records are understandably, the old law and the new law continue the concept that you can't ask government what land they're about to buy. And so there is, continues to be an exception if government is strategically thinking about purchasing property or selling property. The property decisions until property acquisition is completed are not subject to the Open Records Act. The new Open Meetings Law makes very clear, which is helpful, that the voting on any acquisition of property has to take place in public. And that is actually is a helpful development because the Georgia Court of Appeals had reached a different decision. So here's one of the most controversial aspects of Open Records Act law, and that is attorney-client privilege and attorney work product. And that controversy really comes down to this issue. On the behalf of the citizens of the state, when attorneys are giving advice to government agencies, the citizens certainly believe and have a valid argument that we should get the benefit of knowing what that advice is. We should be able to, that advice was rendered for our ultimate benefit, and we should be allowed to know what government are advising the government officials that we are elected, have elected, and are paying for. On the flip side, government attorneys and government agencies have repeatedly raised the understandable argument that the whole purpose of the attorney-client privilege is to be able to deliver candid legal advice in order to allow people to make informed decisions based on this candid relationship, and that if it's required to be disclosed in every instance, it undermines the idea of candor. I'm going to actually read you what is the very long resolution of this issue, and I think there will continue to be debates over what it means, but this is basically where it came out in the process. Records containing there is an exception A41, 50-18-72, A41 is an exception in the Open Records Act for records containing communications subject to the attorney-client privilege recognized by state law, provided, however, that this paragraph shall not apply to the factual findings, but shall apply to the legal conclusions of an attorney conducting an investigation on behalf of an agency, so long as such investigation does not pertain to pending or potential litigation, settlement claims, administrative proceedings, or other judicial actions brought or to be brought by or against the agency or any officer or employee, and provided further that such investigation conducted by hospital authorities to ensure compliance with federal or state law, regulations, or reimbursement policies shall be exempt from disclosure if such investigation are otherwise subject to attorney-client privilege. So it's a picture of clarity. What it does reflect, I think, is this consensus, that when a government agency hires an attorney to do an investigation and the risk of litigation passes, either because the government agency has settled that lawsuit or there was no litigation in the first place, then the factual findings of that attorney are going to be subject to public access. You can't simply have something terrible happen at your government agency and then hire an attorney to handle the investigation and never provide the public with some explanation of what took place. That you can't invoke the attorney-client privilege in that situation if there's no prospect of litigation, if there's no prospect of a subsequent lawsuit. But the contours of the attorney-client privilege and the Open Records Act, I expect to continue to be an area of future debate. So I'm gonna last thing I'm going to touch on is two last things. One new exemption to the Open Records Act, and that is economic development. Obviously, our state competes with other states to try and bring major projects to Georgia. It's been quite successful in that endeavor. There was no exception under the old Open Records Act law for economic development. The governor and legislators became very concerned that put the state of Georgia at a disadvantage. Whether you agree with that or not, there was ultimately a resolution reached in the new Open Records Act law that would allow secrecy to a point for very large economic development projects. The State Department, the State Department of Economic Development, not every agency, but solely the State Department of Economic Development, is allowed to withhold records on those negotiations until essentially a binding commitment is reached. In the world of these economic development projects, a binding commitment has a clear meaning. That is the point where the government agency and the private organization that is locating a facility actually sign an agreement about what government benefits will be given to that private organization if it locates here. So at that point, until that point, the State Department of Economic Development can withhold records relating to the negotiations. After that point, it needs to produce records relating to that issue. It can also withhold records to that point on what's called the Quick Start Program. The Quick Start Program is essentially a program that allows a private organization that's wanting to relocate a facility here to work with government to start getting workers trained in the particular skill areas that they're going to need. And so it's sort of a counterpart to this whole economic development. The thing I'm going to end on here is enforcement. I mentioned to you that there is an increased penalties under the new Open Records Act. That's also going to be true for the new Open Records Act law, but I want to touch on those for a little bit from the Open Meetings Act law. I want to touch a little bit on what are those penalties. Under the old law, there was basically a misdemeanor penalty that was available, a criminal penalty that was available. The new law makes what I think is a significant advance. In addition to there being a criminal penalty, there is a civil penalty for non-compliance. Why is that a significant advance? It is a significant advance because it is going to be available in a much broader range of circumstances. The truth is, the misdemeanor penalty for a violation of the Open Records Act law had been imposed extraordinarily rarely in the history of the Open Records Act. It was cumbersome. The penalty was so small it didn't really seem worth it. So adding a civil enforcement fine is very worthwhile in that it can be done on a much more efficient basis. It can be done by the Attorney General's office itself, but it can also be done by others, by civil litigants. Everybody using the Open Records Act can now pursue a fine against agencies or individuals that are not complying with the Open Records Act. So, the misdemeanor penalty remains if there's a knowing and willful violation of the law. It also adds some new language, which did not exist before and will make for interesting. I will be interested to see whether it gets used in the future. You can also pursue a criminal penalties for attempts to frustrate access. In other words, not a clear violation, but people gets back to this idea: if you are putting so many hurdles in front of public access to records, that too could potentially be a violation of the act. But the civil penalty can be imposed for any person who negligently violates the terms of this article. So all they have to have negligence standard, an unreasonableness standard, civil penalties can be imposed. Those fines are $1,000, up to $1,000 for the first violation and up to $2,500 for subsequent violations. good faith is only a defense to the criminal action. So again, gets this idea of if government is not complying, it can't. They are still going to be subject to a civil penalty potentially, even if they are saying, "Hey, we just didn't know the law. Sorry." That it can't just be that you're saying, "I did it in good faith." If it was unreasonable under the circumstances, the civil penalty can apply. As with the old law, you can still recover reasonable attorney's fees upon either party if an action is brought without substantial justification. So I am already 3 minutes over, but I'd be happy to take some questions if anybody has them. Mm-hmm.
In the case where a litigant uses the Open Records Act to get records during the pendency of litigation, if they fail to copy the opposing counsel or the counsel for the government agency, is there any remedy considered? I mean, what happens if that happens? Do you just bring it to the attention of the court?
That's what I would think. There is no remedy specifically set forth in the Act. I mean, it is, I think, what it is trying to do is alert individuals submitting requests in the midst of civil litigation that duty of copying your opposing counsel will now extend to your open records obligations too.
As a practical matter, how do you compel production from the agency once the 3 days has expired? Because I've done that many times, and it's like 2 weeks later, and no one cares, and responding, so I always wonder what's the remedy, what can you do to get the information you're looking for?
In other words, they haven't provided the records?
Exactly.
Okay, well, so I actually think the new law is a pretty powerful tool in a number of ways. So number one, if they haven't complied within 3 days, and that can be either they didn't provide the records or they didn't provide a written response identifying why they didn't provide the records. They are supposed to do one of those two, either provide the records or give you a written document saying we are withholding the records under 50-18-72A4, the police exception. So if they did neither of those two things, they are now in violation of the Open Records Act and they are facing up to a $1,000 fine. It'd be a little difficult for me to see how they're going to get out of that $1,000 fine. So all of a sudden, you frankly have before there wasn't a lot of teeth in the Open Records Act. Now, if you want, you can go pursue that fine. You have an incentive, in a sense, to pursue that fine. But the next step would be either asking the Attorney General's office to help them. I mean, so the steps that I would take are, number one, contact their legal counsel. In other words, I'd ask the agency, who is your attorney? I would like to speak to them. I think that attorneys are going to acknowledge, all right, we needed to do something in 3 days. And so that step is contacting their attorney, I think, is an important step. If the attorney is not responding, and that can happen, then I think the next helpful step is asking the Attorney General's Open Government Program to place a call or take some action. Frequently, that will cause a agency that is not in compliance to, it will get their attention. The Attorney General has the authority to enforce the act throughout the state, as do any citizens. But so that's the next step, and then ultimately the last step is to bring a case, and the jurisdiction for a case is in the Superior Court. But those are the steps that I myself try and take, involved in Open Records Act requests. I also must say that, to me, if you submit an Open Record request to an individual, even before going to the attorney, if you ask them, who is your boss? Frequently, I mean, we all have bosses. You frequently want to know, well, what are you going to say to my boss? And frequently that will start opening the doors to getting compliance with an open record. But I'm going to go back here.
Right now I'm working on financing arrangement with public authority, and in doing that, there are innumerable draft documents that are sent by email, a lot of emails, paper documents that come into the agency. The deal's done, what restrictions do they have on purging this stuff? Get rid of it, or do they have to keep that forever?
Okay, so that's a very good question. What I spoke today about today is called the Open Records Act, and it's at 50-18-70. There is also something in Georgia called the Georgia Records Act. And the Georgia Open Records Act now cross-references the Georgia Records Act and says a violation of the Georgia Records Act will itself be a violation of the Georgia Open Records Act. The Georgia Records Act is the act that requires state and local agencies, but particularly state agencies, to basically have a system for and have actually a schedule for how they maintain their records. And they're required to maintain certain records for certain periods of time. What you really want is if they're destroying those records prematurely, that's a violation of the Georgia Records Act. But it really depends on the type of record and how it gets designated under their Records Act schedule. But that is a reasonable thing to ask for in terms of they should have a schedule about how they're maintaining their records.